Good afternoon to everybody. The title of the talk is Turbulent Magnetic Field Amplification in Laser Plasma Interaction and its relevance to stochastic heating also and particle acceleration. But I will be telling this first how these magnetic fields are generated, specifically turbulent nature. Actually, this is the joint work. These are the other members of the group who are working in this area. And this is what I am going to present here is a very small part. The other papers or research work is also there, but I will just present the very, very elementary or first, the first, very first work which has been done in this direction. As everybody knows that magnetic field is generated in laser produced plasmas. And it is the simple mechanism. If you look at the equation of motion for the electrons, there is a gradient pressure drop that gives rise to the drift velocity. Because in the laser produced plasmas, the density gradients and temperature gradients are so steep that it gives rise to a drift velocity and hence the current. So if you look into the Ampere's law, then there is a corresponding magnetic field associated with that. So this is how the self-generated magnetic field is there. But self-generated magnetic field has been studied for a long time. But what is interesting, for the last couple of years, I was listening to a talk by Professor Ravindra Kumar at IIT Delhi. Professor Tripathi organized that seminar. He was showing me, he was showing to these in the talk that the magnetic field which is generated, it is having a turbulent nature. And that turbulent nature is having certain scalings. At that time, we were working also in the solar wind turbulence. So when I when we saw that scaling, we thought that it may be having some relevance to the solar wind turbulence, and that type of mechanism probably may work here. So this was the starting point, and we tried to explain that little bit. But certainly, lot of work is still needed to be. done in that direction. So this is what I am going to share with you. Secondly, when these turbulent nature or the magnetic fields are generated, the second thing is how they can accelerate the particles. So I think this is known as the Fermi acceleration. That suppose there is a table tennis ball, and if you give the jump to this, many times, then it will be accelerated and height will be going on. So similarly, the magnetic clouds will be interacting with the particles and will lead to the acceleration of the part. I think this is known as the Fermi acceleration also. So the first thing is how these turbulent structures are generated, and the acceleration part comes second. We have not done much work in that second part, but certainly we are going to do in that direction. So this is the basis of the today's talk. Or objective. As it is known that in the laser plasma interaction, most of the interest is because of the laser induced fusion, and it is one of the scheme, inertial confinement, as everybody knows very well. These are the temperature versus density, the different type of plasmas, and there is a region here. Why I am showing this figure, this is because laser induced fusion and the supernova, they are almost very near to each other. So what I will be discussing, the mechanism of magnetic field amplification or turbulent magnetic field amplification, some of the experiments are being conducted in UK, I think Rutherford laboratory, and they are trying to create this supernova reminiscent type of situations, and their magnetic field also, magnetic field amplification is also being studied. So we shall try to correlate the model which we are trying to develop with that also. This is in terms of density. All right. The mechanism of this magnetic field generation, as I told you, lot of studies are there, and some of these are well-known mechanisms. Density gradients and temperature gradients through gradient pressure terms lead to the drift velocity and hence the current, and by Ampere's law, the magnetic field generation. This is that interesting experiment which was reported in 2012 by this TFR group, and some of the details, experimental details, are given there, in which I think you can read it. What is the typical power of the laser used? And it is mentioned here that it will be correlated to supernova observations also, or supernova reminiscent observations. This is that typical figure which I wanted to share with you. Here you can see that the magnetic field is having this turbulent nature. This is the 3D picture. This is the magnetic field plot with time by that TFR group, and this is that power spectrum. So the initially the slope is having roughly minus 2 here, but in which is roughly minus pi by 3, minus pi by 3 nearby there, and the further steeper part of the spectrum is also there. So that figure motivated us to look into this mechanism and try to develop some model if possible. As I mentioned to you that in the case of the solar wind also, the expanded corona, which is known as the solar wind, when it penetrates the magnetosphere or comes to the heliosphere here, then if it is not accelerated, then it should die out, but solar wind is continuously coming at a constant speed, or sometimes some fluctuations are there, but there should be some constant acceleration mechanism in the case of the solar wind also. This is why it is going beyond Earth also, and Boson region and beyond like this. So that is that typical power spectrum which is observed in the solar wind turbulence, which is also having some inertial scaling in the here minus pi by 3, and then steeper part of the scaling here. In the case of supernova also, supernova reminiscent, specifically the surrounding media, which is known as the clumpy media, which is also supporting some of the waves, and some of the other details are also given here. I'm not expert in this, but some of the material which you have taken from this, and in the clumpy media, the waves which have been observed are like magnetosonic waves, alpha waves, and even Langmuir waves have also been observed. They are rather propagating along or at some angle to the magnetic field. So laser plasma interaction experiment at Rutherford by Minky Talon, which is reported in Nature Physics 2014, describes how the high power laser systems can mimic the supernova blast waves crashing through the clumpy media surrounding an exploding star. And specifically, the supernova explosions triggered when the fuel, that is well known, everybody knows that, the outer soak outtakes the dense clumpy media in the ambient medium. The magnetic field plays the important role of allowing the energy from the perturbation to spread over a large distance with the origin of this large magnetic field in this is also an open question, and which is also not fully understood. And turbulence may be one of the mechanisms or turbulence driven instabilities. So the magnetic field amplification in the clumpy media is also one of the issues which the people are trying to explain, doing some experiments also and trying to mimic these situations. At this Rutherford Appleton Laboratory, the experiment by laser power, laser plasma interaction experiment, these are some of the details which are given here. And these are the results, some of them. They have taken this laser which is impinging on a the wavelength is given, power is given. It is typically focused on a 500 micrometer diameter carbon rod, and hence the plasma will be created, shock waves will be generated, and these are some of the results. So they did the experiments in two situations. One is just blasting it. This is that portion. And in the second experiment, they put a grid here, which is a periodic grid. And then they measured this magnetic field. So once with grid and once without the grid. The interesting result is this one. So when the grid is not there, and when the grid is there, there is a difference between the magnetic field amplification. And this is the field without grid, and the, so there is a difference of about, I think, 3-4 times. This is with grid. And this magnetic field also is also having a turbulent nature, having a typical scaling which is given here. This is reported more details in Nature Physics, 2014. More details of the parameters of the relevant experiment are given there. We shall be using them later on. So what we tried to propose here, that a high power laser beam, which is propagating in the extraordinary mode, is decaying into upper hybrid wave and a magnetosonic wave. The clue for taking the magnetosonic wave was because in the clumpy media, magnetosonic waves have been observed already. And so is it possible? First of all, we tried to establish with the help of three-wave interaction. And this is the corresponding parallelogram. The pump wave, extraordinary mode, upper hybrid wave, and magnetosonic wave. If beta is very, very small, then it is just like a acoustic wave and linear curve. So a parallelogram can be used. And hence, the three-wave interaction can be possible, and energy and momentum conservation is possible. So using this as a basis, that magnetosonic wave is created. In the clumpy media, it is already seen there. So in the case of laser plasma interaction, probably magnetosonic wave may be generated by this mechanism. And if this is the situation, then what is possible? We are trying to understand the turbulent magnetic field amplification and the corresponding power law. So the traditional mechanism of the pontometric force. So what we are considering here is the mechanism like this. The magnetosonic waves, after cascade, there will be so many low frequency magnetosonic waves. So high frequency magnetosonic wave, which is a, say, a driver, is interacting with this low frequency magnetosonic wave and hence modulated or filamented, and hence a noise structure is generated, and hence it will give rise to the turbulent structure of the magnetic field. So these are the steps. Pontometric force is there because of the high frequency magnetosonic wave, pump wave. And this is exciting the low frequency magnetosonic wave. And the localization of this magnetosonic wave and its noise stage. And then spatio-temporal model is developed. Specifically in the TFR experiment, the beta is very low. And hence, in the corresponding case, we have developed this model. This is the geometry of the problem. We develop it the coupled equations by using the standard method, the fluid model, continuity equation, momentum balance, Faraday's law, Ampere's law, combined them together. And we took a very simple geometry first. The magnetosonic wave is propagating, suppose in the x direction. I think I have already illustrated it. X direction. And magnetic field is in the z direction. And this is having just y component, Ey. More complicated geometry or magnetosonic structure can be taken, but we took very simple picture first. If we do it, the corresponding dynamical equation for the magnetosonic wave can be written like this. Substitute the corresponding terms by that, and ultimately, this is the dispersion relation as usual of the magnetosonic wave. And this is the finite frequency correction, alpha, omega by omega ca. For the low frequency magnetosonic wave also, we in same method, and this is the density perturbation associated with the low frequency magnetosonic wave, and these are the Bondamati terms. Bondamati force component calculated, substituted here, and following the Snurd method, we developed the coupled dynamical equation for the low frequency wave, magnetosonic wave, and its driven term is due to Bondamati force by the high frequency magnetosonic wave, and this is the high frequency magnetosonic wave where the coupling of this with this is through the density term, I think, yeah. Density term, this term. So this is a coupled system. Analytically, it is not possible to solve it. So first of all, we took the envelope solution and wrote it into this form. And then we have the dimensionless parameters, and the coupled system is in this form. You can say certain like this, like in a Jacquard systems, it is a high frequency wave and this is a low frequency wave, modified Jacquard system, where the normalized distance, time, etc., are, I think we have mentioned it somewhere. These are the dimensionless parameters. Time is typically in this for the laser plasma parameters, few picoseconds. I mean, roughly half a picosecond, and Xn, Zn, electric field, density, like that. So then we solve it numerically with the help of pseudo-spectral method. And what we did was that the initial magnetosonic wave has been perturbed by perturbation which is in X and Z direction. Otherwise, if you take a uniform one, then the Bondamati force will not be there. And hence, the perturbation is necessary to add to the pump. And by taking this initial value, this is dimensionless, of course, we took a periodic box, two-dimensional box, and then we solve it in time by finite difference method and in the spatial domain by pseudo-spectral method, two-dimensional grid, 128, 128. Before doing the calculations, we checked whether the numerical method which we are adopting is correct or not. So we tested it for nonlinear Schrodinger equation first and find out, because its invariants are known, like number of plasmons. So we checked that up to 10 to the power minus 5 accuracy, and they were recovered by the numerical methods. Then we modified this algorithm for this particular case, this typical case, and these are the parameters. The only thing here is that the magnetic field here, which is taken, this is slightly higher side. In the case of Munder et al. Or TFR experiment, this is hardly 150 or 200 megagauss. So this is one of the assumptions, or you can say that needs the this method or this model needs improvement. This is what we are doing. So this is higher side we have taken. And of course, over dense plasma. These are the results. So the magnetic field starts localizing. And these are the localized structures, amplified also, and you can see that how the structures spread over a large domain. This is in real space, 20, T20, T25, T30, and like that. This is normalized units, which is roughly half picosecond. And if we find out the power spectrum, then the power spectrum is changing, but when the system has reached to the quasi-steady state, we took T29 to T39, I think 10 or 20 spectra, and then we took the ensemble average, and this is that ensemble average power spectrum, which is shown here in the figure. So in the TFR experiment also, they are having two scalings. One is the steeper one, and the one is near minus 2 or something like that. So we are getting some scaling like this, but I think still more work is needed to have that exact scaling, which is already reported by TFR. This is that structure. So they are also having these structures, turbulent structures, and this power spectrum. So these are the results which I just mentioned, have been summarized here, corresponding to that. Now, as I mentioned that at Rutherford also, they are trying to do the experiments and trying to correlate it with these observations of the magnetic field amplification in the supernova reminiscent case. So if we look it, then our situation corresponds to roughly the experiment which is performed by them. It reaches maximum value around 4 microseconds. And our model, the time taken for the pornography post to set up is of the order of few nanoseconds. So basically, in our model, the system reaches to quasi-steady state, and hence there is no need of doing the transient analysis at all. So we can take a quasi-steady state model, and this is that model equation, post which is applicable to this Rutherford experiment. So if we do this, then this will be a single model equation, which can be solved again numerically. And these are the typical parameters corresponding to that Minkowski experiments. These are typical normalizing distances along and perpendicular direction field. And you can see one very interesting thing in comparison to the TFR experiment. Here the beta is very, very large. So again, the same two-dimensional simulation box, 256 grid points, because it was in the quasi-steady state, and hence we can do bit more resolution. And this is the situation. All the initial conditions are mentioned there of the simulation. These are the structures of the magnetic field which have been observed by the simulation, and the corresponding power spectrum. So, as I mentioned that the experiment done by Rutherford group is having two type of observation. One is with periodic grid, with a periodic grid there, and one is without periodic grid. So, when they are using the periodic grid, then the or without the grid, so there is a change in the amplification. Amplification is quite large, or at least by a factor of 2 in comparison to without grid. And this is what we are also saying, that when the perturbation is there and when the perturbation is not there, so perturbation is there, pornography force is finite, and hence it leads to the pornography force and hence the magnetic field amplification. So in our case also, we see this situation, but they put the grid there and we put the perturbation. That is the similarity between the two. And this is the scaling which they have observed. And these are the results which have been compared the model which we are discussing and the experimental results here which have been mentioned. Parameters also, as I mentioned, the one of the shortcoming of the model is that the magnetic field has been taken higher side. I think we are working on that, and we have reached to a reasonable value by taking some modification in the model. Now, the second part of the problem is that once these localized structures are generated, can they hit the particles? And this is a well-known Fermi acceleration problem, that magnetic clouds, how they accelerate the cosmic ray particles. So similarly here also, once these magnetic field structures are generated, repeated interaction of the particles with these structures will lead to stochastic heating. So in this case, you can represent this turbulent structure or the localized structures like cosine, like this, and this is the spectrum, different part of the spectrum. write down the equation of motion and do this using the Fokker-Planck equation and calculating the velocity space diffusion coefficient and quasi-linear theory. This is a standard method actually. One can calculate the distribution function and the energetic tail of the particles. We have not done it for the present case, but we have done it in the case of solar wind. In fact, where one of the biggest issue is that how the solar wind accelerate the charged particles. This is why if the solar wind is not accelerated, it will die out and it will not reach even to the Earth or to beyond Earth. But there is a constant mechanism which is accelerating the solar wind also, or the charged particle of the solar wind. And that mechanism we discussed some time back with the help of stochastic heating, and how the different charged particles, depending on the Q by M ratio, will be making the different tails of the distribution function, Maxwellian, modified Maxwellian. But we have to work for the present case in Laplace interaction case. And there is another approach which is known as the fractional diffusion approach also. So we are working on that. That's all. Thank you very much. What they did was that they took this carbon rod, blast it by laser, shock waves are generated, and the surrounding media is ionized. In the second experiment, they put a grid, periodic grid, which just like a strip which is having empty space periodically. So basically, when the shock waves are passing through that grid, then in the second case, they saw that the magnetic field is amplified at least 2-3 times more in comparison to without grid. So that is the experiment they performed. So same type of situation we try to create in the simulation, that the wave is there, pump wave is there, and we add a periodic perturbation. Periodic in a special domain, XZ. In the electric field of the pump. No, electric field of the electric field perturbation. Yeah, modulated. So, like experiment, it is a simulated type of situation. Because, so physics-wise, what we think is that they are adding the this grid, that is adding some perturbation there. I mean, adding means making the field non-uniform. Because shock waves, when they are passing through this inside the grid and without the grid, when grid is there, there are some periodicity or perturbations are there. They lead to the bondomotive force and hence the corresponding amplification.
When you study the parametric problem,
yeah.
The role of that modulation
in terms of this is a implementation problem. The first mechanism which I mentioned, it was just that extraordinary mode is decaying into upper hybrid wave and magnetosonic wave. So usual energy and momentum conservation with the help of that parallelogram. In the parametric problem, that is just a decay process. But in the filamentation or magnetic field amplification, the perturbation is there, otherwise there will not be bondomotive force. Yes. Right. Yeah, actually I have mentioned here the total time observation for that self-generated magnetic field is typically of the same order which is the required for filamentation here to grow. We have just calculated nearby. That is nearby there. In fact, I did not mention much thing here, but there are 2-3 interesting things. I should say that TFR group is doing a lot of interesting physics. And one of the interesting physics they are doing is that they are seeing some terahertz generation also in this high power laser plasma interaction experiment. So we have tried to develop a model that depending on the nonlinearity which you are taking, suppose you take a collision nonlinearity, the sound wave will be generated which is of the gigahertz range. I think this is coming in POP recently. But if the nonlinearity scale is different, like fundamental nonlinearity, Then we are seeing that in the turbulent spectra of the anacoustic wave, laser beam and acoustic wave interaction, then the terahertz anacoustic waves are also generated just like TFR experiments. So there are a lot of interesting things which are coming up. And second thing is that in Rutherford experiment, they are trying to have two colliding laser beams. So it is just there are two galaxies which are colliding. That type of experiment they are also simulating. So we are trying to develop a model where as in the case I have presented here one laser case, but suppose second laser is there, then the fluctuations by the second laser, they will be working there and they will amplify it. So what they are saying that the power spectrum which we have seen here is also modified because of the colliding, and that change in the power spectrum also we are trying to explain, and we have got the result. So I think Narendra is here, is doing work in that direction.
Okay, so let's thank the speaker again.